host, Carianne Sauce, and we have a special guest today, Scotty Bowman. And we're going to have a hot show today because we're going to be talking about a special issue that don't really get a chance to talk about very much because of the passing of Ron Scott. You know, he used to be on the case with the police and the community as far as the relationship and how they function. So we're not going to hold up. We're going to jump right into it, and welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Well, what you got for
you? Okay, well, I started a group called the Crack Detroit Residents and Business Civilian Oversight. And the reason I started that is I became acutely aware of a lack of information reaching the community about our Border Police Commissioners. We've had a Border Police Commissioners since 1974, but for the most part, people can get by or get some without really knowing a lot about them because they weren't elected. They say, you know, appointed 100% appointed board. You know, they have been with the 2012 charter, and if we had the opportunity to elect our police commissioners, which meant that people should be aware of them, at least to the point where they're voting for them. Unfortunately, when I found that at one point I was a candidate in 2017, when I found out in the course of going kind of talking to people, is a lot of people did not know, for instance, that it was a civilian organization that did not need to have police experience to be on the board. A lot of people did not know it was outside of the police department and an oversight body rather than being somehow part of the command structure internally. A lot of people didn't understand that this was a place where they could go if they had problems, if there were either a lack of police response when they thought they needed the police, or an inappropriate police response when the worst case would be, for instance, abuse.
Now, will you repeat that name of that, I guess you would call it, I wouldn't call it a statute, what you just said, because that's very important, because very few, even myself, didn't know that they had an independent I wouldn't want to say, I guess semi-investigating unit outside of the police or somewhere where you can address your problems with the police department.
Right. It's called the Board of Police Commissioners, and which is called a non-start in 1974. Before that, there was an individual commissioner, and because there had already been a problem with abuse by police officers, there are especially particular units called stress and force. The development of that then over the years is that for a long time we appointed post, and what's changed is people can now elect their police commissioners directly starting in 2012 charter, which influenced the 2013 election, in which the first elected were received. Since then, we've had other elections, and in 2017 was the most recent one that resulted in not being seen as it is. There's actually, I should say, when I say elected, there's 70 elected, one per district, and there's 3 at large who are appointed by the mayor.
Well, see, that's something I know a lot of people are not aware of, because I know I was, and I kind of thought the commissioner, I didn't think that it was independent. I thought it was part of the police department, not the branch of the police department. So I'm being informed just as well as the audience.
The separation is important because...
Yes, it is.
Yeah, it requires a certain degree of independence. I mean, if you're going, for instance, to court and you're going to be on trial for something, ideally one does not have jurors that are friends of you or friends of the person who arrested you. Or if it's like a civil case, it's not connected by two parties in a civil case. There's needs to be a certain separation for fair conflict of interest, and that's one important aspect of this, having shows whether or not someone's been lifted or not. They have the final word on the department to take, you know, initial steps, but it's ultimately up to the Barclays commissioners whether those steps are followed through or whether additional steps are taken.
Yes, it is. That's good to know, because now you know the process of how it's going to work. Like, if you do have a problem with the police, say you file a complaint or something, and you don't feel as though they are really conducting a thorough or expedient investigation, would they play a part in something like that?
Yes, that would be part of it. The complaints can range from effectively inappropriate action, ineffective action, all the way to the point of actual negative undesirable action. So there's a full range, and all those cases would be broken down. It's very often on the office of the chief investigator. And the chief investigator has the duty of investigating those complaints and reaching an independent conclusion and then bringing those findings to the board. Now, one thing I want to add is because we have this body and its role is very important, I don't necessarily find myself in agreement with them a lot of the time. And to some extent, I don't think they are living up to the responsibility that they're being. And so, on the one hand, I definitely think we need that Barclays Commission. I think everyone needs to remain elected. And by the way, the charter that I mentioned, 2012 charter, it went to effect in 2013 for practical purposes. That charter is already facing revision rather prematurely because of the clause that was put aside in the state. And what happened is we had a vote on it in August that most people didn't even know it was on the ballot until they got there. A lot of people looking for it on the ballot couldn't find it. It passed by supposedly 175 votes, but it was part of a recount effort. Whether or not that's even a reliable vote was a big question. And it actually does, but so we have a Borough Police Commissioner, and we have a Charter Commission meeting now, and they rewrite the charter. It's effectively the Constitution of the City of Detroit. Whether or not this body that I'm talking about continues to exist after the charter revision is an open question, whether or not the city government is at all recognizable is an open question, because that can all be changed. Keeping an eye on people's news has been very well attended. I think there's more interest in the Charter Commission now than there was definitely more than there was before the election.
I've attended the last three meetings, and yes, it's more community involvement, and it should be, because people don't really understand how important the charter is. You know, you got a federal constitution, you got a state constitution, and basically, that charter can become like a constitution. But what they have done, they have taken the sworn oath out of the procedure. When you take an oath, it's in your charter, you take an oath to the state, in the federal constitution, where it used to be the state, federal, state, and the charter. Now, they need to put that back. And if they was to put that back, the citizens would have more control of what's really going on. And they have more control of the elected official, because they will be bound by that charter. But right now, you can say they violated the charter, but it don't have any teeth because you don't take an oath to uphold the charter. You only take an oath to uphold the state and federal constitution.
That's a crazy paradox to say. Right. The office the person is swearing into would not exist.
Yes.
It was not for the term of the charter's opinion makes the office exist to begin with. And the person isn't swearing to follow the very document that they established in an
continue to go to the charter meetings because you probably can have some important insight, but right now they're just hammering out, I guess, the structure of it. You know, they went through the bylaws yesterday, and they, you know, they're going to get there. It started off a little crazy, but now they have toned down and seem like they're conducting themselves like they should, and seem like we can get a lot of things done. I'm glad you mentioned that because that's what I was going to do anyway. So I'm glad. Yes. Both of those meetings I'm going to make because the budget is very, very important. It's like now they're functioning and you don't even have a budget. You know, how are you going to give the citizens a copy of the bylaws or whatever it is that we're talking about if you don't have a budget?
Thank you. but still not much more interesting to think about the town city in Detroit. There is an entity larger than some small national governments in some places that have this very large organization with a substantial amount of money they can handle. And just so there's the police department's budget, which is one of the biggest proportions in the city's investment.
I kind of agree with you on that, because what I'm seeing is that they put the cart before the horse. First thing, if you're going to have any kind of body function, the first thing you need is a budget. You can't function without a budget. Like, well, gave them a copy, each one of them, a copy of the Freedom of Information Act, because I wanted a copy of the bylaws. The previous one, the ones that we're supposed to be going through now, because they said it was 127 changes. If you got 127 changes, ain't no one in the world you're going to have the same document. You didn't really rewrote the whole bylaws. So they was having a little problems with that. It seemed like they kind of growing and ironing them out now. Because I notice now they are kind of going around more with Robert's rules of the order. Because they kind of wanted to and didn't want it to, because the Robert's rules of order are very strict on what they say. It ain't no business to do it this way or no way. And I noticed that they weren't quite ready to completely accept it, but then they turn around and say, we're following them. Well, you can't have it both ways. Either you're following or you're not. So it's gradually coming together, slowly, but it's coming together. They did. Oh, yeah, because you really can see the difference, you know, in the way they was, you know, talking through the chair, and, you know, I said, oh, okay. Somebody picked up a book and read something. So, you know, that's good to see, because actually we are going through history right now. This charter can be a catalyst for us to get everything back that has been taken and destroyed and ended to us. But first we must, that's the first thing we must do, is get this charter right. That's why I'm kind of committed to going to the meeting. If I'm not there, I make sure that I got somebody there that's going to relay me the information of what's going on, because it's very, very important. Because if we get this charter back the way it was, where all the elected officials have to take an oath to the charter as well as the Constitution. Now, you got things in the charter that the Constitution don't even cover. But they'll be bound by that charter. But right now, it's just a piece of paper, you know. You know, then the only thing that they can say, they'll take you before the ethics committee. Well, that sounds good, but it don't have no teeth. it's nothing that you can do, you know, spank your hand and not really do that. So, because I went through that ethics committee meeting, and when they got through talking, I said, well, what can you do? And what it boiled down to is, well, we can kind of chastise them verbally, and that's it. No real consequences of what you do. So, you know, I was glad to see they talked about that was in the charter, but what would make that stronger is once they put back the oath, and that's one of the things I'm going to be working on, because I know Sam Black, he was one, that's what his pet peeve. He was always talking about taking allegiance to the charter. And I kind of understood it, but I really see the importance of that now. Because, you know, that would be the city's constitution. And everybody would be obligated to follow. That's your elected officials and everybody else. You know, like, you know, they talked about, well, and then they didn't just talk about it, it was a fact that the debt was kind of stacked with a lot of Duggan supporters. They were carrying his water, but I can see that even they have seemed to come around to saying that the people dissatisfaction of what's going on, because when they had public comment, people let them know that they knew what was going on and that these people was elected by the people, not Duggan, not Gilbert, not nobody else, and they should function accordingly. So that point has been made more than once. So I guess they got the message. Then I also heard that Robert Davis was supposed to be contemplating a suit. But the last thing I heard was that they said they don't have the necessary funds to go forward. So I don't know if that may have changed. Now, I'm not quite sure on that. I'm trying to find out some information about it, but I will find out more, hopefully this week, because the last person I talked to, that's the information that I got. That they hit a wall. I think it was. Last I heard, I think it was collecting like $200, and that ain't very much money, you know. If you got a group of people involved, but, you know, short of that, he might not have to do it now. It's probably based on that first meeting that was chaotic. I believe that's what he may have been basing it on. So I haven't seen him at the meeting, so I don't know where he's at this point.
Experience when I was on the side of the other switch, results would break down the time when you get a pain.
came on the show because you made a lot of things clear. And for those who are out there watching, I know it brings some insight, especially to the charter, since we are going through the charter now. And we have an opportune time to put a lot of things in there that may have been taken out or that need to be added to make it stronger, because one of the things that I think need to be put in there, if it wasn't in there, need to be put in there, is the fact that any elected official running for the city of Detroit for any office should have to be here at least 5 years. Not no 2 years or flying. We need to get rid of that, because with that requirement, now you have somebody that's really from the community, not somebody that just flew in from Livonia or somewhere and just, you know, was here for a minimum amount of time, and that's even debated. So to offset that and make sure that that never happened again, we can add something like that in there. We got more than enough problems with what we can solve ourselves internally, right? Because you know, just from what I'm seeing now, I see that we can get a lot of things done. And when we get to the part about adding things to the charter, right now they're just going through the bylaws and the formality. Now, one thing I want to emphasize to all the people out there that's listening is that if you feel that it's something, first thing you need to do is get a charter. If you don't have one, get one. Read it, go through it, and see what you feel that it needs to make it better, to benefit you. See, one thing about this charter, this is the only document, now like the Constitution, well, you have a little bit to do with that. But with the charter, you have everything to do with it. You elected the official who crafted it. You can put different things in there. You can take things out. And if you don't like how certain things is going, well, you can add that in your charter. I think it's the Detroit City Charter. I think it's on Facebook.
Going on work, they need to first Thursday. I'm sorry, every Thursday at 3 p.m. So every Thursday except the second Thursday at 3 p.m. Then at the public safety headquarters over on 3rd, I think it's 13 and on 3rd. It's a police headquarters. And you go there and you walk in and there's a shutter ID and there's a meeting room upstairs. Over there at the end, they have public comments, and that's where you can step up and bring up your concerns. You can also, you know, try to reach them on your own, and get your investigator on the other bank, you actually look at the concerns. There is also community meetings. They have every second Thursday, there's usually around, I think, 6 or 6:30. At locations around the city, they become flooded as my news group gets there. So, one thing I noticed is that a few of them where I've spoken out, they've been kind of quiet about this. But initially, if some of the viewers recall, in the summer, there was a case where the corporal had been recorded. Punching out a patient that they had brought in there. And she was impressed. She was fairly petite compared to the person punching her. There were actually there 4 to 5 officers present. At least 2 of them were actually holding on to the lady. They were swinging. I know myself watching this a couple of times that an officer behind them looked like they were trying to pull off. So there was some indication that there was something not being right with what he was doing besides the actual organic feeling that this doesn't look good. But then what happened at the meeting, the purpose pictures were, and then this was until December, they finally have a meeting where they vote on suspension, and the incident happened back at the end of July. So they go and they have a vote on whether or not to accept Chief Pratt's recommendation to suspend the officer. Well, what followed was there was a line of several police officers, one after another, some of them saying they were trainers, all saying that this conduct was okay. In fact, not only saying it was okay, but they were emulating it, they were doing the same thing themselves. That made me feel far less comfortable than watching the original video of them doing it, because one video of them doing it, they looked like a rogue cop, and something happens. But when he got a line of people who are involved in the training aspect of things, including saying that this is okay, that was very disturbing to me. And we followed up with a press conference where myself and Charles Williams and my partner, the Deputy Commissioner, we actually went out in front of the city hospital during some of the hours, expressing our displeasure with this man. The majority of the board members voted to reject Chief Pratt's recommendation for suspension and to keep the man on duty and paid. Since then, I guess I've heard the chief has kept him off duty, but he's still getting paid.
This is the case.
Yeah. And the board has not taken any further action against him. The judge dropped the misconduct and office charge against him, which was the most serious charge. So all that's left is an assault charge. So the bigger concern is that I've got to say that there isn't, that it's a small matter that this woman was abused the way she was, and that there can't yet to be any consequences that way, but that the larger matter is we have apparently a systemic problem where there is a consensus of a lot of officers, and this is the way they handle things. And so the board, and I had brought this up at one of the meetings, the last one included, needs to set policies that say, no, this is not okay, so they can't go up there and say, it is. someone to catch.
Right, right.
On the table to table. And makes an argument back and forth, thinking, well, let's vote on the motion. We all voted, and it was never said, and we said it passed, and it never stated what the motion was. If they actually voted out or what actually passed, but the last thing we discussed was the motion to table. So, there you go. There's a good minutes where on the Roberts rules, you actually get the opposite outcomes.
Well, see, just off the top of my head, that's violation of the Open Meetings Act. Any public entity has to go by the Open Meetings Act because they're a public body. They're not a private club like, you know, the police seems to think that they are. And one thing I want to know, how was it well attended as far as the community is concerned? When they have these meetings?
Yeah, there's often people there. I think we need to get a lot of people.
Yeah.
On a regular basis. But yeah, there are definitely people from the community. It's quite interesting. There's a lot of people from the police department.
Yeah, that's what I figured. It's kind of expected that.
So, they get people, you know, not from the community. Occasionally, get some good responses from so, you know, Charlie, the Duff, and the Justin Hartson.
not an ordinary individual. I got an emergency in the time I called you back later. Well, I'd like to work with you on that, police commissioner, because what I can see there is people scared to challenge the police department because it is the police department. But just based off the top of my head, what you done told me, I see about 3 or 4 violations that they need to be written charges right up against the police department. I'm willing to do it when I get a little more information. Time, and what I want you to do, I want you to come back next week because my phone is lit up and haven't even had a chance to take any calls. Callers, tune in next week, and I'll make sure that you get in so we can hear your concern. It's just that it was a lot of information, and I wanted him to get as much of it out as he could, but as you can see, we still just didn't have enough time. So you need to support this station and this program. HR legal issue. I got about three callers here. All callers, call back next week. We're going to have Mr. Bowman back. We're going to continue this discussion for the first half of the program. Hopefully, we can get it done during the first half. But if not, well, we just have to do the whole show again. So, like our song would say, this is the fastest hour in showbiz. And keep tuning in and make sure you get a copy of your city charter, the state and federal constitution, and your basic human rights pamphlet. And also your Administrative Procedure Act. With those few documents, I call them reference documents, whatever issues you're dealing with, one of them will cover it. Plus, I might as well say the Open Meetings Act, too, because it seems like every time I turn around, more and more just want to rob a baby's pet peeve. But I see that it's a big problem over there with the police department, and they need that Open Meetings Act enforced. So until next week, God bless, and we'll see you.